Hey guys, this is Tina from Quantum Healing with Tina. I'm a Beyond Quantum Healing practitioner, spirit release therapist, and intuitive empath. And today we're here with Karen. Say hi.
Hi, my name's Karen. I'm intuitive starseed, energetic healer, BQH practitioner, and channel and medium.
Hi, Karen.
I got it.
You did it. And today we just wanted to have a chat about anxiety, right? Anxiety for me is the most uncomfortable feeling ever. And I remember in my 20s, my early 20s, when I started getting like anxiety attacks and like panic attacks, which I never had before, and I didn't even know what it was or what was happening, and they seemingly came out of nowhere, right? But after learning a little bit about anxiety and what it actually was, I realized that I had had it all my life. I just functioned in that way. I was just always anxious as a child into my adulthood. And I really didn't get a grip on it until my just a few years ago, really. And so that's, probably about 40 years old before I really started to get a grip on it, and understand what it was and why it was, and that it was trauma based, really, from all the like suppressed emotions over a lifetime. And not knowing how to process emotions or how to feel through things because, number one, no one ever taught us. And number two, we never felt safe enough to do so. So, because we didn't know how to process it, we would just stuff it down into the body and stuff it down. And then it would come out as panic or anxiety attacks because it would reach like a boiling point where you just couldn't stuff it down anymore, it would just roll over and come out. And that's really what an anxiety or panic attack is, right?
Yes. Me too. My first boil over was when I was 21. And I was diagnosed with that, like anxiety and major depressive disorder. And I was so excited because I felt validated for the first time, or kind of gave me like, okay, there's something. You're just making that up, or you're not overreacting, or so I had those like attacks, like a really bad anxiety attack, which is what how I got diagnosed in the first place, was because it was so bad that I didn't know how to what to do, what to deal. Like it was a loss of control at that point. Can't breathe, like where you can't, like your breath is just out of this, out of it. And
Why?
yeah, that's the fly I saw before. And it's my grandfather. And yeah, it was so bad, like really, really bad that I didn't know how to stop it. And the only way that I thought I could stop it was if I were to jump out the window. So that was the one thing where what I told the emergency doctor, in which he put me in the psych for a little bit. And my wake up call for that was when they came with my food and they gave me plastic knife. And then I'm like, okay, I gotta reevaluate shit here. This is crazy.
Yeah, right.
Yeah. And I mean, I was triggered by, yeah, it was again the core root of abandonment. So, and that was my first, actually, now that I am reflecting back to it, my first narc stun. Big one.
Explain what a narc stun is.
Narc stun is, how do we explain a narc stun? I guess like when something, I don't know. I don't even know how to go about that. It's just like the reaction that you get or that you feel when what happens.
when a narcissist responds to you in a way that's invalidating.
Oh, yeah. And I was heavily gaslit too.
Gaslighting.
Big time. Yeah. Like that was it. And I was, you know, when you're just at a loss for words.
Right. It completely stuns you. You're just like paralyzed. You're like,
yeah,
what just happened?
Right.
And you can't even find a response for it because it's so ridiculous.
It's so ridiculous. And it's a little bit of everything that you have all to work on, like a lifetime of what you've suppressed and need to work on. So when that happened, I had no words. I felt really dumb for feeling the way that I did because of my, like, feeling invalid for my feelings. I felt also, yeah, it was the first time, like, I felt like, well, first time that I felt something and I didn't, what was it? It was just, yeah, like you're making a big deal out of nothing. I thought I told you that already. And I was just like, did you? That was the first time my reality was questioned. And I'm like, did you? Because I was pretty sharp at knowing things. And that, but here's the kicker here, which is why I doubted myself even more. It was because I went out with my parents and I was drinking a lot. So I was drunk. So that's why the reality was kind of like, did I make that up or am I overreacting because I'm drunk? But underneath it all, you know. Like, it just doesn't feel right. You just know.
Yeah. But they will take that, your vulnerability, and use it against you.
Oh, God, yeah.
Well, you were drunk, so you couldn't remember.
Right. And you're overreacting because you're drunk. Like, it all went down to the drunk.
Right.
So, yeah. I just remember that feeling. Like, it was just so whatever. And it happened a lot. Just that loss for words and, yeah, it's just really just a lot of loss for words because it's like I can't even imagine putting someone in that awkward position and you can't even call them out because you can't, you're stunned. You're just so stunned that you can't even say anything. You're everything, you lose everything, your voice, your rationale, or like you automatically go into an old trigger response where you don't feel valid and what you're thinking is irrational. You're overreacting.
Well, that's
so dumb.
And that's in psychology what they call the freeze response. Mm. Fight, flight, freeze, or fawn. And the freeze is just being completely paralyzed and just not even knowing what to do.
I learned that today.
Did you?
Yeah. And I was just like, I didn't know I was a freezer till you just said it. For things like that. I'm usually not. I don't even know what I am. Am I a freezer?
Okay, I'm a freezer.
Yeah, big time. Yeah. And I'm like, yeah. Give me a click.
See, we're always learning.
Click. Click. I thought I was, that's funny. Okay.
What did you think you were?
Why are you looking at me like that so you can make fun of me?
No.
I'm freezing. I'm not a fighter. I think because I was put myself in a position of what, I guess, I don't even know. Freeze, I guess.
Yeah, freeze. I'm definitely a freezer.
Yeah.
Or if it's a really threatening situation, I will play along and like fawn. You know, that's another one.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
I'm definitely.
Oh, well, that's what I did when I was with that predator last, when I went to go visit you. I had to fawn it.
Right.
Big time.
Yeah.
So, yeah, we're similar.
Yeah. It's interesting. Yeah, I guess it depends on really what the scenario is, what
right,
your reaction is going to be.
Right, because when it came to the accident that you had last August with the water explosion, I didn't freeze. I was very calm. So what's that?
I think that's a normal response.
Oh, good. A healed response.
A healed response.
Yeah. Okay. Great. Okay, good. All right, check. Not a freezer anymore. Depends. It really depends, because if it happens out of nowhere sometimes, it still stuns me. I don't know when the last time I got stunned, but I know when it happens, like, I recognize that that feeling of, like, what the fuck is going on? Or you're just so in disbelief.
Right.
Like, what the fuck just happened?
Right, because with someone like that, you're seeing two different realities. And they try to take yours and twist it to make it into something it's not, to make you question your own reality. They know what they're doing. It is purposeful. And they do that so they can get the one up on you.
Yeah. That's a sneaky shape-shifting.
Yeah.
I don't like that.
It's gaslighting. Yeah.
Yeah.
That's what it is. And when you go through it consecutively for years and years and years and years, you get to a point where you don't even know who you are anymore, because you don't trust your reality. You don't trust yourself at all. And you depend on that other person to tell you what's real. And that's how you start to lose your sense of self in these toxic relationships. And you totally don't trust yourself at all anymore.
Here I am thinking I'm like some kind of compass.
Compass?
Like I had it all, like I knew what I was doing. I remember when you told me about that reality that I was living. I didn't believe it, obviously. Like, it was just like, no. Can't be. It can't be. And then, like, I was getting proofs of it happening. Like, physical proofs. And I was still denying it. And then that reality set in. And I just started crying in the car. I remember I was crying in the car. When it really, like, settled in on that truth of that relationship, it just sit. And I was like, oh my God, I am a victim. I was a victim. But yeah, you don't realize it, because I always put that person on a pedestal.
Well, that's it. It took me a really long time, too, to wrap my head around the fact that I was technically a victim of emotional abuse and gaslighting and all of those crazy games that they play. Because you don't, covert narcissists are the trickiest and the most dangerous, because you don't see them coming. They come veiled in goodness and in a way victimhood, you know, like they're just always the victim of everything and oh, poor me and everybody, it's everybody.
Oh my God, yeah, we see that in the community too.
Yeah, it's everywhere. It's everywhere. But to be in a relationship with someone like that, and then they are also gaslighting you on top of it and manipulating your reality.
Yes. It's so subtle.
It's so subtle that you don't even realize it's happening. And then when you find out and start to even question it, it takes you a long time to really put the pieces together, because it's so hard to believe that you've been living like that for this long, being abused, and you don't even know it.
Right. I know. It's so hard to pick up the pieces of your sense of self after that, especially after when just that hard reality of what it is and how long you've been in it and the life you've built around it and who you were before and who you are now, or when you realize that. Because I mean, like, I remember when that happened, I didn't even, well, that's when I had my awakening too, like a little prior to that. And yeah, it's just a mind fuck. I remember feeling like, so shocking. I was so shocked. I guess I did freeze.
Yeah.
You can't believe it. So yeah, that was traumatizing. But it took a lot of hard work to understand why you attract somebody like that. Or what are you mirroring? Or what you needed in that person to fill that void in yourself, or whatever it is. Just that codependent thing.
Yeah.
It's very toxic. Yeah, so there's a lot of people who are in these intertwined relationships that don't know what healthy relationships are. And they're just playing out, you know, if they're in a shit relationship and they don't know how to get out, or they don't know why or how they attracted them. I mean, if you don't, technically, I mean, if you don't do the work and you don't recognize why, then yeah, you're just going to keep repeating it until it becomes very, very obvious and perhaps dangerous.
Yeah.
You know, it has to push to the point of danger, perhaps, in a lot of them, especially like those kind of abusive relationships where, you know, your learning is just a repetition all the time. Attracting the same partner is what you see in what you're just mirroring what you learned in childhood, perhaps your parents' relationships, or what you've seen your parents doing.
Right. That's it. You're just mirroring what you learned as a child. My relationship was an exact mirror to my parents' relationship, but I couldn't see it. Like, if someone would have told me that I was married to my dad, I would have been like, you're crazy. What are you talking about?
Right. I was just like, absolutely not. Our communication is great. We talk sometimes about stuff. I at least apologize.
All the time. Yeah. Yeah. Well, that's it. Because when we don't heal, we're just on a... we're just automatically repeating what we learned in childhood without even realizing we're doing it. And so that's what we do. We fall into relationships that mirror our parents and what we were taught growing up. And that's it. Until we learn to recognize what we're doing and the relationship that we're in. And we need to learn about that and learn about the dynamics in that relationship to be able to understand it. And why we ended up there. And, you know, because you can't just place all the blame on one person. It takes two to tango. And even though you were technically the victim, you're still responsible for your part in it and why you ended up there. Because you have to take responsibility for your life and stop being a victim of life. Because everything happens for a reason. And I learned the most about myself from that relationship.
Right. What you're willing to accept.
Right. And what I'm not willing to accept anymore. Like how low my standards got. You know?
The bar was so low. I think the bar was just kind of like
gone.
Cracked on.
The bar was gone.
There was no bar. It was just whatever. Just take what you can get.
You take what you can get. Yeah. And you're just always invalidated. It's a suppression. And a lot of these people are in what they call the Black Heart program, where they're incarnated on Earth right now to be in relationships with people like us, to suppress our light. But that's also for us to learn the lesson of finding our light again. And then shining brighter than ever before. So these suppression mechanisms always end up backfiring. And just like what's happening now in the world at large, Yeah. All the suppression techniques they're using are just backfiring because people are getting pissed and they're not accepting it anymore and they're waking up, you know? So yes. it's kind of like the same idea. And really these relationships are huge catalysts for growth and evolution if you're willing to actually do the work and look at yourself. And it really is a requirement in healing and moving forward.
Yeah, that's a big one. That's a big childhood wound right there. You're just carrying into adulthood.
Yeah, because you are like still a child because you haven't done any of the work. You're just walking around in an adult body, but you're still a child. You haven't learned anything yet.
Great.
So it's in examining that relationship and then, you know, it's not just examining that relationship, but it's also looking at your childhood and realizing that what you thought was a normal childhood wasn't normal at all. And, well, I shouldn't say normal, but it wasn't healthy at all. Mm-hmm. Because it is very normal for a lot of people. But I would have told you I had a normal childhood. It was fine. Everything was great, you know, whatever. But really looking back on it, it wasn't at all. Like, it was very much chaotic. And
that was your normal?
That was my normal. Chaos was my normal. And I was a very sensitive child. So that was... It was very difficult for me. And it was a running joke. Everyone used to say it. We don't know how you ended up in this family. that's everybody said it. We don't know how you ended up in this family because I just didn't fit there. Mm-hmm. And I think so many of us, you know, so many of our clients say the same thing. They hear the story all the time. You were the same way. You didn't fit in your family. And it's like we're born in these families to heal their trauma, the generational and the ancestral trauma, to heal that.
Yeah.
And, you know, for the future generation, so they don't have to keep carrying it on. And also to be the light and to anchor the light down into that family too, and to not carry on those traumas into adulthood, or at least, I mean, we do for a while, but then we recognize and heal them. And that's part of our role in incarnating in choosing those families, because we chose those families. There's always a reason why we choose our families. And most of the time it's because we want that to be the catalyst for our healing and to heal not just for our individual selves, but for the family and, you know, generations to come and, you know, our ancestral line, clearing for the ancestral line. And especially right now, you know, with the shift happening, there's so much clearing work happening. Mm-hmm. So many of us are clearing these old wounds. You know, and with my family in particular, it came with many, many different traumas and wounds and all kinds of stuff.
All of it.
I mean, it really was everything, you know, a little bit of everything.
Yeah, a little bit.
Yeah. I can't even think of it all right now, but. And, you know, but I, you know, and there's nothing against my parents. They did their best and I loved them. Like, I loved my parents. I would never say a bad word about my parents. They did their best, but they were just functioning from their own trauma, you know, and that's what ends up happening until someone comes along and heals themselves and stops the cycle. Then it just keeps repeating.
Yeah, I used to think my parents were terrible at showing it. But it's also because they didn't love me in my love language, you know? Yeah. It's like, hold me. Tell me you love me. I didn't say none of that. I used to love it when I remember, like, I'm having, like, a flash to the 80s where I see pictures that I took, like where I'm wearing my little nightgown and my mom's holding me, and I want to be like my mom because we're posing the same, you know. Like, I gotta find those for you.
I would love to see them.
Yeah, I'm cute. And yeah, but I mean, like, I just love being with my mom, and yeah, so it's just, I think that's the only like memory of that. The 80s, such a long time. But you know, I you know, like when I was talking to you about like how I was, oh yeah, right after I got diagnosed with that, yeah, my mom, they bought me a bed.
Yeah, and I was like, you to get rest,
right? I know now, but at the time I'm like, are we going to talk about like that I just had an anxiety attack, or that I was like, they wanted to prescribe me medication? Like, are we going to talk about that? Like, that I went to the emergency today and they gave me like a plastic knife? Nope. Give me a bed. So, you know, like it's a weird translation, but I mean, obviously getting out of it and waking up and understanding your family dynamic and you also carrying those traits of not having that kind of communication, the stuff that you want to talk about. But then I was thinking, I was like, wait, but if we actually did talk about it, would I want to talk about it? What would I tell them?
Right.
Right. But back then, I didn't know that it was because I got stunned.
Right. Right.
Yeah. I would have been too ashamed to even say it because it was so dumb in my head. Right. You know? So we just don't talk about it. Or, you know.
Right. And looking back, you can see that they obviously cared about you, wanted to do something for you. They didn't know what to do. They didn't know how to communicate. They didn't know how to ask you if you were okay. So they bought you a bed to show their love. Like,
it was a pretty good bed.
Right. But that's their way. That's their way. I mean, my parents weren't perfect either. Like, my dad couldn't even get the words out of his mouth when I would
literally.
Literally. Okay, I love you, Dad. You're like, yeah, okay. Like, you couldn't even get it out. But I knew he loved me. I felt it. I knew he loved me. So it never bothered me that, you know, he couldn't say it. And he was very cold and distant and non-emotional. And I was scared of him. I was scared of my dad. He never hit me. You know, but my brothers did get hit when they were young. And my dad just had this loud, booming voice, you know, that would just like echo through the house when somebody was.
Oh my God. Like, yeah, that's when you feel the soul. I know that scream. I've done it.
Yeah.
Yeah. Where you feel it shake from within you. And then you're like, oh my God, who's that?
Yeah, and that was just naturally, he just had that kind of booming voice. So anytime he would even raise it a little bit, it was loud. Yeah, I was always scared of him, even as an adult. Yeah, I remember as a child, just my bedroom was the only, like, clean and safe and organized place in the house. So I just used to hide out in there all the time.
Yeah.
Yeah. And looking back, I see that I had so much anxiety because the environment was chaotic all the time.
Right. You know? You have no control there.
No control. I never felt fully safe, I guess.
Yes.
But I was lucky because my mom didn't work. She was home all the time, you know, whereas your parents worked and you just like wanted somebody to be home with you. You know, I at least had my mom home all the time.
I had my grandma and my grandfather, but my grandma was hardcore, like really hardcore.
Well, she's really, yeah, an old Filipino lady.
Yeah, very, very like rough. Not rough around the edges, but she was just like, had no filter. And she'll tell you, you know, if you're too dark or black or fat or whatever, she'll tell you.
Yeah.
Yeah, she was like an old Catholic racist.
That's how my pop-up was too. Like, he would tell me all the time how fat I was, and
I mean, right. I was never told I was fat, but I mean, like, my sister or whatever. Yeah. And it was just kind of like,
hey, you gained a couple pounds there, huh, teen? Like, stuff like that. Oh, my. Like,
right, but I was so black. You're so dark.
Yeah.
Yeah, I used to talk back, like, when I got a little bold when she stopped using her slipper. I was like, you're darker than me. I ran.
That's a rebel. Mm-hmm. Yeah, but we were just talking tonight about, like, some of, like, the root of a lot of our anxiety. We have a lot of performance anxiety, like, when it's time to be on camera or do something new.
Yeah.
Karen and I both have... Do you want to tell them our angel wing story?
No, go ahead. I'll add my two cents.
So when we were in kindergarten, both of us were in kindergarten, and we both had to do a Christmas play, and we were both angels, and we both have traumatic angel wing stories from kindergarten that, like, traumatize us for the rest of our lives.
Forever. For all performance, doesn't matter what. I think, like, our first thing, like, you know, I was all like, yeah, let's do YouTube, you know, until our first video came, and I was just like watch the first one that we performed together. It's terrible. People laugh because I'm so awkward. But that's it, you know, like, it's just that worry or fear of screwing up. And, you know, and there's a lot of people watching. My angel story was, I had to wear that long white gown. Mm-hmm. So it is. Yeah. And I had, what do we call that thing?
A halo?
Yeah, but
what garland?
Was it? Garland, halo. And I had, my grandfather made me these angel wings that had hanger, old... like metal, the ones that turn in, grab at your, like, right in there to hold. They were, like, you know, out, and they had, like, also garland around,
mm-hmm.
the back, silver, I think. Yeah, silver, and cotton balls. It's cute. And I believe, like, when I was walking, I tripped on the dress, which is why I don't like dresses. Most of the dresses that I wear are pretty long. Like, there's no, I'm just not doing that. So, yeah, tripped on the dress, fell. Garland. Hanger. Right there, because you're tense, right? Because you fell in front of people. Also, mm-hmm. a traumatic stun.
Yeah.
Because you realize, you know, like, when you fall, you know, there's that point of, like, oh, my God, I just fell. And, oh, my God, everybody's looking at me. And, oh, my God, I can't see because there's garland in my face. And I tripped on my dress. I hate dresses. Why am I doing this? This is so dumb. Never again. Yeah, never again. You better freaking believe never again. I didn't do anything after that. Every time, like, for Filipino festivals and things like that. Oh, no. I said no. I did do church stuff. Like, I was an altar server because you could have girls. And I called sick a couple times. It's like, who does that? Like, yeah, coming in today.
Yeah, well, my angel wing story is super similar. It was the kindergarten Christmas play, and I had the long white dress and the garland halo, and my aunt made my wings out of 2x4s.
What?
God. 2x4s. Yep. On a 5-year-old's back. Do you know how heavy they were? They hurt so bad. And I think they were actually held on with hangers too. I can't remember. It's so traumatizing. I'm telling you.
It is.
I just remember the embarrassment being so overwhelming.
Right. Because the worst part is that it's dark. And I had a, you know, the light. I can't, like, I was just like, and not knowing that you're a sensitive child, but you know people are looking because you feel it.
Yeah.
You feel it. You think you're embarrassed. It's the people are embarrassed for you.
They're going, oh, look at that poor little girl.
Yeah. And you're just like, just take these out and.
Yeah, I don't remember falling or anything. I just remember feeling so embarrassed. Like, it was overwhelming embarrassment.
It's out of body. Really out of body. I mean, metal things go in.
Everybody else had these cute little wings, like, made out of, like, poster board or something. I'm like, why do I have tree on my back?
You're like carrying the crust. You're like, I'm in like backwards Jesus. I was just like.
It really was. It was so heavy.
I bet.
Oh my God, it was so heavy. Yeah. So anyway, I think that's the root of a lot of my anxiety.
Performance anxiety?
Mm-hmm. I don't have it anymore. I really don't. Like, I never I had so much anxiety that I couldn't even leave my house at one point. Like, the agoraphobia was real. And I never... that's when I woke up, when I was in the deepest part of my suffering. I woke up and I knew I could start healing myself. So I did. But I never imagined that I wouldn't feel that way anymore. That I wouldn't have anxiety like that. Waking up with it every day, like feeling that anxiety before you even open your eyes in the morning, you know, like that brief couple seconds.
Yeah.
When you wake up from a dream and before you open your eyes, like that it's
the
state of brainwave.
I remember you used to tell me about that.
Yeah. Before I would even open my eyes, I would feel it in my gut. I would feel it right here. And it was just the worst. Because you never just feel okay, you know? It's just that constant state of anxiety. Anxiety is my least favorite feeling. But right. What I really think anxiety is all of our suppressed trauma and emotions that we've suppressed over our lifetime.
Right.
And not only that, but our nervous systems are so damaged from...
It's a good word.
Everything. Right. Yeah. They're fried from being in a state of fight or flight all the time, being in a narcissistic relationship, in a toxic relationship with someone. You never feel safe. You never felt safe in your childhood. You bring that into your adulthood, into your relationship. You never feel safe. You're constantly in fight, flight, or freeze. And that's it. You don't know what a level, calm, stable nervous system feels like. And it's not until you start healing those wounds. And listen, healing comes on all levels. Like, you have to do it all together, like the physical, emotional, and mental, and spiritual. It's all interconnected. You can't have one without the other. But So it's like a multi-level approach to healing. For me, at first, it was mental. It was just catching my thoughts. You know, when I started with the negative self-talk and the criticism all the time, it was just catching that and turning those thoughts into loving thoughts. And that was the start of my journey. And then along the way, you know, you start digging deeper and deeper into things and, you know, really like digging up the root traumas and the core wounds and start healing them. And, you know, it's like putting all the pieces of your puzzle together. Like I just see the guy with the map and the pins on the board, you know, and you start connecting everything and putting all the pieces together. And then at the same time, like physically healing the nervous system and the adrenal glands, which get totally burnt out when you're in a state of fight or flight all the time and walking on eggshells. So physically, you know, anxiety is also a physical issue. It's the body reacting. It's always in a state of reacting.
I remember when you first moved into your apartment, talking to you on the phone, and I just could feel you pacing.
Mm-hmm.
Pacing. Yeah. And I'm like, you're supposed to be peaceful now. It's just pacing. But that's the body's reaction. It's just waiting. It's on guard, waiting for something to happen. It's just like, why is it so quiet? It's gonna come soon, you know, like it's preparing.
Right, but it's not conscious. My mind felt peaceful, but my body wasn't. It wasn't used to being in a peaceful environment. So it didn't know what to do with itself. I had to be doing something all the time, you know, to fill that to fill that space. So I was constantly cleaning and doing laundry and like stuff that didn't need to be done just to fill that space, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. So the point is, you can heal from anxiety. It can be done. Mm-hmm. Yeah, you might have things that come up like from time to time, but if I could go from a constant state of literally not being able to leave the house to waking up every day with no more anxiety, then anyone can heal their anxiety. It just takes the time and dedication and commitment. And if you want to heal, you're going to have to put in the effort, you know?
Yeah, you really have to put in the effort. No one can do it for you. That's the thing that we need to stress to people. No one can heal you. We can be guided to your healing, but you ultimately have to do all the work.
Yeah.
You are your own project.
Right.
Yeah.
Well, and it's a radical idea for people because we grow up in this environment where we're not taught that we can heal ourselves. We're taught to look outside of ourselves for something that can fix us. Right. Whether that's a doctor or a medicine or a therapy or whatever, it's always outside of us. We're always mm-hmm. looking outwardly to doctors or whatever. But no one can heal us. We have to do it ourselves.
Yes.
It has to. You have to commit to yourself. It's that commitment. And what it was for me was, I don't want to do this all over again. That's what it's always been the driving force for me. Like, I know that I chose this. I chose these specific lessons to come to Earth this time to overcome. And I don't want to come back and do this again. That's why I'm like, I'm dedicated to not repeating this again. And so that's the driving force behind, that's my motivator for healing and really getting past those traumas and healing it and not having to repeat those lessons over and over again. Because if we don't heal it, and learn those lessons, we'll keep repeating it over and over and over again. And I'm just so over it, you know, I'm just so over it. I want it done. But the mm-hmm. only way out is through. You have to go through it. There's no easy way out.
No, there really is none.
Mm-mm.
I'm always working. I'm still working on myself all the time, even if it's just healing my body from the trauma. I'm always checking in that way too, because that was one part that I didn't realize was, you know, like the full way through the trauma stored in the body. Like we always think like mentally, like, okay, that should be enough. Meanwhile, the body is its own vehicle and its own.
We'll talk about that, how that works.
Body healing or just the body response?
Well, the whole, like, you thought you were healed because mentally you understood it, but you were still having an emotional or bodily
response. I was feeling things. So, like, even though, like, I knew better, like, through all the mental work, like, really got out of the, like, the mental slavery and understanding mm-hmm. how things were happening and why, and understanding, you know, like, knowing how to ask myself questions and, you know, is it rational what you're thinking? Like, all these questions, like, I triage myself whenever I'm going through something or I feel the anxiety. So then mentally I could just assess and then be like, okay, it's fine. You know, like it's just that it comes from this. So I'll go, like it always trailed back to my core wound. So I could address the core wound, address whoever's involved. So if my inner child's there, then it's that. If my ego, you know, there's a lot of that stuff going on. And then, you know, you convince yourself that you're so on it. But then the body is screaming. So you have that and it's still persisting. Even though you're telling yourself, you're like, no, I know, like I'm fine. The body's emitting a completely different energy.
Right.
And it's saying a different language. So that's what would happen between me and her. She would always ask me, like, are you fine? Like, are you okay? And I'm like, yeah, I'm great. Like, I'm fine. But she was feeling my vibes were not matching my words, even though mentally in my head, I really did think I was fine. I just was not body aware of what it was screaming. So then coming to understanding that, I had to learn how to heal the trauma that my body was screaming. So every time I would get triggered, I would have to teach my body that it's safe. So yeah, we talked about this like a couple of times where...
Well, what does a body trigger feel like?
For me, I feel heat. I feel my palm sweat. It's kind of like an anxiety attack. I get hot. My whole body gets hot. My ears get hot, hot, hot. And I just feel it like just take over. I know you feel me sometimes, so you're just like... Yeah, my body just gets hot. And so then, like, usually when I would feel that would be like an indication, but also there are thoughts coming in. So sometimes it's like there are no thoughts. So I'm like, why am I feeling like that? So that's why I would ask my question. I'm like, what are you doing? Is there anything happening? No, no, no. You know, I go through my questionnaire and then nothing. So I'm right. Like, well, what is it? So then I had to address that the body is trying to get my attention, and I had to learn how to speak the language of the body, which took some time. And through that kind of stuff, I would have to, I did somatic healing, which is like a lot of touch. So it's just like kind of like giving yourself or your body, you know, some affection, or just holding it to tell it that it's safe. So if you're getting a trigger response, it's just to hold yourself and tight. There are different parts also that I would touch on myself, where if I was feeling triggered or something, then I would try to find it. So I would push on certain parts just to see where it soothed. It felt like I was being soothed. For me, it's in my throat here, which is really bizarre because I would never let anyone touch my throat for a while, a long time. And now it's like where I get soothed. Mm-hmm. So it's really interesting, which is where I had an entity actually. Mm-hmm. Attached there. They didn't want me to soothe myself. And yeah, there are other things that they say to just hold, like put your hand on your heart and just do this, hold here, one hand, like, you know, touch it like your heart, and the other on your shoulder, like so. Tina and I do tapping. She does like tapping for me. So if I need, like, if I have, feel like I have a stuck emotion, I'll just kind of tap the emotions out, you know, like up and out, which helps a lot as well. Yeah. So usually they're just stuck emotions. It's not necessarily like a trauma that you could per se like pinpoint. It's just that feeling of unsafety is replaying in the body. So it keeps going on a loop, even though you can mentally be okay. Your body, the language is not the same. So you have to actually teach the body, because it speaks a completely different language, that it's safe. So you do that just by doing that. And now it's just like, I still do tapping, you know, like I'll just randomly be working and I'll just start tapping just in case, just to see if anything comes up. Or if I'm feeling emotional or whatever, and all I can do is tap, I'll tap just to acknowledge that I feel it. Like it's, I know it's there. Yeah.
Yeah. Good work.
Thanks.
Yeah, because trauma isn't a mental thing.
Not all mental.
It's a body response. It's the trauma is stored in the body. And you might not even know why you're having a certain feeling come over you. But it's tied to a past trauma. You don't even need to know what that trauma is. You just need to be able to tell your body that it's safe.
It could be a mental game. I mean, like, you know, if you don't have a healed or integrated ego or inner child or whatever it is, yeah, it's going to come up with a lot of stuff to say. It's going to bring out all your insecurities, and it's just going to put it all out there, and you're going to have to look at all of it. Or if you're like a suppressor like we used to be, it's just like, okay, just stuff it down. That's not true. We're fine. I'm going to take a nap.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Learning to process your feelings all over again. You know, teaching your own self that, because no one taught us how to do that. And like actually sitting with feelings when they come up, instead of ignoring them or denying them or pretending
or changing them right away, or
having to change them.
Yeah, like you're not allowed to feel that, so I shouldn't be feeling, you know, like that rationale, like I shouldn't be feeling that, you know, my life is great.
Yeah.
And it's like, why? Yeah, so you're suppressing in that way, like even though your life can be great, you're still allowed to feel. Let it happen. But again, if you don't know these things, you know, just, I found, you know, I find like there are certain tools that we are introduced to as we're healing that work to a certain extent until it doesn't work anymore. And then you got to level up.
Yeah.
So they're always coming to show you coping mechanisms and tools just to kind of ease you into it, because it's not like you realize that you're traumatized and you're already like, okay, you know, like,
yeah. Yeah. I mean, it's really amazing, like, how our journey has unfolded the way it has.
You're lucky.
I mean, really, it's, like, been in these, like, divinely orchestrated steps. Mm-hmm. It's like, okay, here's step one, and we're just, like, going along. Okay, here's step two. Okay, level up, level up, level up. It's just a constant level up.
It's a lot of leveling up, and it's a lot of facing yourself and
over and over and over again
every time. And I remember like when I was going through a really rough and bad time, like a really dark period, and you told me, you're just like, I don't know, I think you probably have like bipolar disorder. And I was like, oh god. Or what was it? Or I forgot what he said. And I was like,
borderline?
Yeah, borderline personality disorder sounds like that. And I'm like, oh, let me do a quiz. Because maybe I do. You know, like, you don't know. Maybe I do. Maybe I do. Like, we don't know.
Right.
So you have to do something, you know, be aware and try to cope and do your best. And look at yourself. I mean, these things are just like label things, but I mean, like, you don't have to get so caught up in that. But
they help you understand yourself. You don't need to get caught up in the label, but they help you to understand. Just like if you find out your mate is a narcissist, you can't get stuck into that label and start labeling everybody a narcissist, but it's there to help you understand.
Even though they are.
They are. But it's there to help you understand how to deal with them, understand the dynamics of your relationship, how you ended up there. Labels are useful to a certain extent. You just don't like keep them and stay there and be that. You know, you transcend the labels. So, yeah.
Yeah, but so I transcended my bipolar. Oh, no, my borderline. Yeah, transcended.
Yeah.
You really do think I still have that? Still tiny. Sometimes. But, you know, you have to work through it and not get so kick yourself down. It's hard. It's not always going to be on the rise. It's just that your on the rise is going to be longer. After you do a lot more healing, your rise goes up, and then it's going to show itself in another way, another experience, another face, another everything, and it's going to kick your ass, like, really bad. Really kick your ass, like, hard. So you're going to fall off that high horse and be like, why am I regressing, and feel sorry for yourself for a second, and then you have tools. The tools are, you know, that's what they prepared you for, falling off your ass, like, from all the way up there. But then you see, again, you pick yourself up, you learn, you evolve, and you grow. So then you're up again. It's always temporary. Everything is temporary. Like, even the high, it's all right. Temporary.
It's an expansion and a contraction, and we're just always in that flow.
I just feel bad for people who are always in contraction. It's like, can't they get a break? Yeah, do the work.
Yeah.
See yourself. Meet yourself. I mean, the reason why you're in contraction is so that you see yourself. Look at yourself.
Right. And that is the point of having anxiety or depression or a mental illness. It's to look at yourself and
not
understand
outside.
Yourself.
Stop blaming.
Right. Or looking for something outside of you to heal you, because you're the only one that can do it. The only one that can do it. And yeah, there are people that can assist you and put you in the right direction and guide you. But you have to be willing to honestly look at yourself and look at your dysfunction. That's really what it
is. Right. It's really facing your ego. Not a lot of people can.
Without judging yourself, you know, and understanding why you are the way you are and how you got there, and without any judgment, but really with a lot of compassion and self-love. And yeah, and that just the willingness and dedication to even want to heal and get started in that, you know.
Yeah, especially when your like partner tells you have that, you may have that. That could like really like wreck you if you're not ready to hear something like that. But yeah, if you're just willing, I mean, you have to be ready. And look at the hard stuff. It's not easy. It was never going to be easy. That's why we've avoided it for this long. Right? That's why you avoided it. I mean, like, it's just too hard to look at.
Well, I mean, and part of the reason why we avoided it was because we just didn't know any better. We didn't know how to look at it. We didn't even know that we needed to look at it. We didn't even know that we were in a relationship, in an abusive relationship. You know, like, sometimes you just don't even know what to do. So, yeah. But I find that the freedom that comes with healing, the liberation.
Oh,
I
God, mean, yes. It's so worth it.
Yeah. Just not having that anxiety every day is worth every second of the hard work it took to heal myself. Mm-hmm. Oh my God, that was just awful living that way. And I lived that way for 40 years.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, I would do it all over again. I would never want to be, and you know, anxiety medication and antidepressants, they just make you worse. And they give you suicidal thoughts. I was listening to a doctor yesterday who's a psychiatrist, and you know, he's the kind of person that's open to looking at all the studies, not just the ones that they tell you to look at. So he looked at all of the studies on antidepressants, and, you know, they show you the good ones. They only show you the good ones. So he looked at them, the ones that say, well, they work this much or whatever. But then the companies had a whole, like, backlog of other studies that they don't show anyone with negative results.
I don't think I was a negative result. I the second time when I had my relapse of major depressive disorder and anxiety attacks, that was after how many years? 12 years after the first time I was diagnosed. And so I decided to take the medication the second time around. Almost done. Releasing. Yeah. It didn't do anything for me. And my doctor just kept increasing and increasing and increasing until she reached the maximum dose that a general practitioner could prescribe. And I wasn't even off for like 6 months at that point. It was a quick rise. And then getting off of them, because like I had done so much work, I really took advantage of that time off, being off work, to heal at least the mental stuff. That was a really big one. Like a big chunk of the big, the mental stuff. And yeah, when they weaned me off of that, it was terrible.
Yeah.
Because I went from max dose to like it was a fast wean, a really fast one that I was just like, I don't think I'm getting any side effects. And then I would hear like monkey symbols in my head and I would shake. And I'm like, oh, is that one? I think that's one.
Yeah.
And it was like shocking, like shock electric, like, shocks. And I asked the pharmacist, I was just like, okay, I'm going back to work like progressively or, you know, and really soon full time. Like, what are the side effects? How long are these side effects going to be? And he's like, at least a month. And I was like, a month. And he's like, and don't operate heavy machinery. I'm like, that's my job. And you're telling me not to operate heavy machinery. And I was like, I go a month, and then I really like took my power. I said, you know what? No. Because I was really at the top of my game at that point where I said, no. I go, I'm not going to have the side effects. They're not going to affect me. I'm not, if they shock me, I'm not going to be like, oh my God, why is this happening to me? You know, like, it's going to be like, no, okay, you're good. Thank you for coming. Thank you. We're going to regulate. And it only lasted no more than 2 weeks. So I halved it. And I was back to normal after that. Well, normal. But whatever brain damage happened before that. But yeah, normal. Yeah. I came back to whatever. So, I mean, like, there's a lot of stuff that you can do by not feeding into things, like not taking it as the absolute truth. You have a lot of power in that.
Right.
Yeah. Yeah. Anxiety is a lot of thoughts. So, I mean, like, just assess yourself. Like, what am I thinking about? Is something happening right now to trigger it? And you can kind of ease yourself through it, breathe through it, and then it should subside. It's not a permanent fix, but at least it's something that you can use, a tool that you can use while you're in it, and try to remember that.
And what I use, I used present. I just kept bringing myself back to the present moment, to the now, to the right now, and reminding myself that I was safe and nothing was happening. I was fine. You know, it's just the body, again, the body doesn't recognize that it's safe because it's in that fight or flight. But presence was a big, huge game changer for me. And it really is a practice, you know? And if you do commit to practicing it every day, just bringing yourself back over and over and over to the present moment, it just becomes your state of being, you know? And you don't have to remind yourself anymore. It's just where you are. You're just here right now. You're not thinking about tonight or tomorrow. You're not thinking about last week. You're just here now. And that's just it. And it's also...
It's so true. Now that you're talking, I'm just kind of like, you're right. It's true. You don't realize that you're out of these things. Remember that you're saying that? You're like, you don't realize, because Tina had a chronic illness for a long time. She didn't realize the pain that she was in until she has pain again.
Right.
You know, like you forget. You easily forget. Yeah. Which is really cool. I mean, like how resilient the body is and how everything all works together when you do a complete, you know, healing or shadow work
overhaul
on yourself.
Yeah.
Yeah, all of it. How everything comes together and merges. They all want to work together. It's just that we had separated ourselves or we had functioned in separation.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And it's like you don't even realize how far you've come until you either re-experience your old symptoms again or you remember what it was like back then. You know?
Right. Which is why we're doing this video today. Like, we both, well, I did, got heavily triggered for today, having to perform and do a video with our beloved colleague and teacher, Candace. So bad.
We're just reliving our kindergarten trauma today.
I know, that's why we're talking. I was just like talking. I was like, I'm Karen.
We should have worn our garland.
Hold it, my wings. Don't look at me.
Yeah, you were really triggered, but you did good. I didn't even notice.
Girl, yeah, right. Don't lie. You're such a bad liar.
I
didn't notice. I know, because both of us were like...
funeral face.
Yeah. So yes, hard work. If anyone wants to know how long we've been doing this work on the healing, I mean, it's still an ongoing process. So don't get that mixed up like me, where I thought I was all healed. When did I start? I guess when I woke up. So that was 7 years ago, over 7 years ago. So it takes a lot of time. It can take a lot of time. And it's always going to keep going. So
but
you can't always just be love and light. You have to do work too.
But you do notice, once you start healing, once you just even make that decision not to be a victim of life anymore and take back your control and your sovereignty over your own self and stop giving your power away to anyone, to doctors or other people or whatever, even medications. I'm not saying stop taking your medications. I'm not a doctor. But
no,
you start to take your power back from the things that you've given it away to, and you realize that you really do have the capability to heal your own self. And the point of even having a BQH session, for those of you out there that really need healing for chronic illness or mental illness or whatever kind of illness you have, the point of it, doing it in that state, in that deeply hypnotic state, is that when your body is in that relaxed state of being, it has the ability to heal itself. And that's why it's so powerful. So if anyone needs a session, please reach out to us. Check out our website at quantumhealingwithtina.com. All our links are always below. And you know, a lot of people have healed all kinds of issues from having BQH sessions. I just heard a story the other day where a woman walked in wearing hearing aids and walked out without them. Like, how cool is that?
That's awesome.
Yeah. And, you know, lungs that were scarred at birth that have healed, and knees and anything. I mean, I can't promise you a miracle, but it's always worth the chance. So, yeah, and it worked for me. Like, you know, it didn't work immediately right after my session, but 6 months after my session, I looked back and I'm like, oh my God, I'm not in that pain anymore. You know, which really was incredible.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Incredible.
So healing is possible and available for everyone.
Yes.
You just have to want it.
Yes. Right? If you need any, absolutely. I want it. I was so sick of suffering.
Right.
it has to get to a point where you're just sick of it, completely done, that you're just like, okay. And then you start seeing results, and then you start playing into those results.
Yeah, it's kind of like when you go to the gym, too. Like, most people don't go to the gym until they're, like, so sick and tired of being, like, whatever, just feeling gross, and then they go to the gym. And, you know, you start seeing a little bit of results, and then you're motivated to keep going and keep going and keep going. It's the same thing with healing. I don't know why I'm so itchy tonight. Sorry.
The fly landed and pooped. Sorry. Now you have to wash your hair.
But yeah, you really do start noticing changes right away.
Yeah. Just by wanting it. You know that excitement? I remember feeling that excitement. Just that change in perception changed everything.
Yep.
Everything.
Right. Yeah. And don't get discouraged if you do feel like you're having a regression, like you say, or a backslide, because healing isn't linear. Like, it's a spiral. You're always, always, always revisiting things that you thought you healed over and over, and unraveling deeper and deeper layers of the same issue. Like you said, it shows itself in all of these different ways to make sure that you really got it.
Oh God, they want to make sure you got it. I know, I love that. I love when they like take you off your stilts and you fall. The way I see it, like, you know, climbing the mountain, it's like the, you know, the game on Price is Right?
Yeah, I just saw that.
That's it. Yodeling all the way up.
Yeah. All right, I'm tired. I'm going night-night. It's 12:30.
All right. Thank you for being here, everybody. And if you have any questions or comments, we like comments.
We do.
If you made it till here, probably not.
Probably not. But if you did,
maybe we should have said that. We should say that in the beginning.
Yeah.
We're offering people if they want to they need no. Okay, we're not. What? No one's gonna get here anyway.
What are we offering?
Oh, I mean, like, if people need help in their healing, we're here to.
Of course, we're here. Are.
What are we offering? Healing. We're like healing ourselves. Yes, we want people to heal. Like, that's we're very huge advocates for healing. Like, that is the one thing I'm just like, you're not gonna get anywhere if you're not gonna look at that.
Huh? Well, especially right now, like, everyone's traumas are being triggered from the state of the world that we're in, and people don't realize, like, we can't heal the world outside of us. The only thing we have control over is our own selves. And if we all, like, imagine if every human on the planet focused on healing their own selves, what would happen?
God. And stop blaming it on everybody else.
It would be paradise.
We wouldn't be divided. No. Everybody would just be looking at themselves.
Yeah.
Holding that thought in space. It exists.
Yes. So that is how you change the world. You change the world by changing your own inner world, because your inner world is a reflection of your outer world.
Yeah. You really got to look at the stuff that you're feeling, understand your thoughts, or be aware of your thoughts and how it makes you feel, and see your actions that are based upon these thoughts.
And beliefs.
They'll tell you.
The deeply hidden beliefs you have about yourself and the world, and how true are they? You know, most people never even look at that. And a lot of people have the core beliefs of, I'm not enough, I'm not worthy, I'm not valuable. Like, just tackling that one is huge.
We'll do another video on that.
Okay. Night, everybody.
Good night.
Thanks for hanging out with us. In our angel wings. We'll see you next time.
Bye, guys. Love you.
Bye.